What is an abstract class, and when do you use an abstract class in Java? That's coming up next. When we look at a recipe for making bread, there's really more than one recipe in front of us. Baking bread at altitude has a different recipe than baking bread at sea level. What we really have is a template recipe for making bread, and if we're at altitude, we insert instructions for altitude baking. If we're at sea level, we insert instructions for low altitude baking. The template bread recipe cannot be used until we insert the instructions for high or low altitudes. We need a way to handle this situation in our Java classes. In Java, an abstract class is a class definition where we don't provide all the implementation details. The class has the keyword abstract added to it here. We denote abstract classes in our diagrams by making the class name in italics. We can also mark some of the methods as abstract. That means we just provide the method signature and the return type, but we don't provide the Java block that implements the method. We mark the methods with the keyword abstract. Note, the method has no braces, no implementation, and just ends with a semicolon. Again, we use italics for abstract methods in our diagrams. If we declare a class as abstract, the methods may or may not be abstract. We don't need to have any abstract methods in our class. It would be weird, because what would be the point, but we can do it. The opposite is not true. If we mark any method as abstract, we must mark the class as abstract. Another note, we can't have a method that is abstract and private. We couldn't access it, and there's really no point. If you're protecting it for subclasses, you'll want to use protected. Other than that, there's no difference between an abstract class and a regular class. We can have an implemented classes, attributes, and static variables. We can even have methods that call abstract methods. That's where the real power is. Like in our bread recipe, we know we have different ingredient and cooking steps. So, we can have a cook method that calls these three steps and will specify what to do in the child class. So, how does the Java abstract class help us?
Abstract classes differ from classes because abstract classes can't be instantiated. The functionality isn't complete. This just won't work. We can't instantiate an abstract class. If we try, our Java program won't even compile. Our bread recipe has all the steps but leaves out what to do in key parts. Abstract classes give us a way that we can create a high altitude bread recipe and a low altitude bread recipe. These are implemented as child classes that we can instantiate. We use abstract classes when we know the methods, but we don't know how they would be implemented. In previous lectures about subclasses, we just left the method blank. It's a much better practice to not implement the method at all. There are very few instances where implementing an empty method in Java is a good idea. The reason is, if someone was using our class, they wouldn't know they needed to provide an implementation. When we mark the method as abstract, anyone using our class has no choice but to provide an implemented child class. They can't instantiate the class otherwise.
This is called compile time safety. Compile time safety ensures that any classes that extend our abstract class must provide the bare minimum functionality to work.
Another reason to implement abstract classes is to provide functionality we know all the subclasses will use. We know all of our bread recipes will have a make dough method, so we can provide the implementation. This way, we don't have to repeat the method in every subclass. Repeating code in subclasses is pretty much universally bad.
All right, now that we've seen abstract classes, I'll add a word of caution. Abstract classes force you to expose your class as inheritable. We can't mark an abstract class as final, since to use an abstract class, we must have a subclass that implements it. That might not be a great idea, because we can run into problems as we've seen in previous lessons. In fact, with Java 8, I'm quickly running out of places where I'd want to use abstract classes. We'll see why when we get to interfaces and defender methods. All right, thanks for watching the video, and if you have any questions, let me know in the comments below or on dgu.com. New videos come out every week, so make sure you subscribe. That puts videos in your YouTube feed. And if you like this video, you know what to do. And with that, I'll see you in the next video.